role, kind of life to you. And if all's going well, I should be streaming on to both YouTube and Facebook at the same time, which is the first time ever doing a simulcast. So I'm excited for that. Today I have a very great show for you. It's a question and answer show. It's going to be a live question and answer. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to just, as always when I do these shows, is I'm going to just give a short little tutorial. I want to talk today about sleeping with disc bulges and why that's a problem and what you can do. And then I want to show you some exercises. Actually, I'm going to try to share my screen and show you some exercises here. And that may help with disc bulge complaints or any low back complaints as well. So if you're on live right now, I welcome you. I'm just going to load up the video here so I can see the live question and answers as well. So the live chat box will be on, and let's see here. Should be on, but if you have any questions while we're on live, do leave it in the chat box or on the replay afterwards, and I will do my best to answer questions while we are on. Let's see if I can turn this on over here, manage. I'm using a new platform that's simulcasting in two different platforms. So hope it's working. Should be. Right on. Okay, so the first thing I want to talk about is sleeping with a disc bulge. Let me just get my screen share ready. Okay, good. Okay, I'll get that there in a moment. So if you've ever had a disc bulge, it can be very, very painful. One of the biggest complaints I see is, and people tell me, is waking up in the morning with serious low back pain, hard to move, very difficult to move. There it is, the chat box is on. Great, that's good. And difficult to move in the morning, lots of pain, more pain in the morning than in the evening when going to bed. And it's very, very common. It's one of the most common things I've heard with my patients that have bulging discs in the lower back, disc herniations, and whether it's low back related pain, gluteal hip pain, or leg pain, sciatica type pain. So it's one of them, it's very challenging. Now, the reason why it happens is I have a video on this that I will link in the description below. I talked about this, is morning pain with disc bulge. You have to imagine the disc is a weight-bearing structure. It's a load-bearing structure. When it's healthy, it does the job very well. It takes the loads and the pressures of your body. You get this here. So there's a disc right there, okay? So it takes the loads and the pressures of the body very, very well throughout the day when they're healthy. And the way the discs are designed is they're a strong fibrocartilage type of a structure with a nucleus pulposus in the inside. Very provides shock absorbing capacity. When they're healthy, they work great. And how they develop and how they get their nutrients and their water and eliminate waste is through movement and imbibition. So when the body's weight is on the spine, the disc will naturally during the day compress a bit, totally normal. When you're lying in bed at night, they now expand a bit, which is totally normal as well, and they're drawing in fluid, right? They're not being loaded or stressed as if you're standing or sitting all day. Now, if there's a disc injury, okay, so disc injury just like this over here, imagine that now, that entire disc structure with the disc bulge and herniation during night, while you're sleeping, while you're resting, now is also expanding because of imbibition, drawing in of water and fluid. Then you get up in the morning, you sit or stand, and now you're compressing it, that injured disc, and it's inflamed. That will cause a tremendous amount of pain in the morning. And that's one of the main reasons why people have pain in the morning when they suffer a disc bulge or disc injury. So what I recommend to do is a couple things. Number one, sleeping position. Now, I've seen patients in my office with serious disc bulges and disc herniations and serious pain associated with it. And I understand that I've seen it. I understand how challenging it is to sleep in that situation. I totally get it, 100% understand. So some things you can do to make it easier, possibly, is to lie on your back and place one or two pillows under the knees. So you're flat on your back, you're placing one or two pillows under the knees, just like that, where your knees are bent, and that will help relieve some pressure in the lower back and also in the nerves that go into the legs, the sciatic nerves and the peripheral nerves that extend from the sciatica nerve, the sciatic nerve. Also, if you're sleeping on your side, you can put a pillow between your knees, just like that, and that'll help level out the pelvis and decrease pressure and irritation in that lower lumbar disc area. So that's something that can be done. The other thing that you can do is some mobility exercises. Very, very light stretching if you can. You can do some side bending mobility exercises, usually to the opposite side of the disc injury or leg pain. So if you have left sided leg pain or left sided disc injury, then you bend to the opposite side to open that injured side open, okay? So that's some mobility exercises you can do the night before you go to bed. You can also do seated pelvic tilts. I've done a whole video on this. I'll post in the description below. Seated pelvic tilts, that will help as well, mobilize it. And then first thing in the morning, while you're lying in bed, flat in bed, if you can, you can do also pelvic tilts in the lying down position. Okay, so forward pelvic tilt, backward pelvic tilt, and lying down position. And if you can do it seated, you can do that as well. So some light mobility work as soon as you get up in the morning, get that spine moving, that's work out those kinks and the stiffness that's very common in the morning, that will help. Okay, so that's some tips you can do in terms of sleeping position with disc bulge and also mobility work before you go to bed and in the morning. Okay, so that's the point number one that I want to mention. And I'll bring up a picture here of a disc in a moment. What I want to also talk about too is I've been mentioning this for a while. And for those of you that are live, I appreciate you for being on live. I already see some questions on there, which I'll get up to it in a moment. And this is my first time ever simulcasting and streaming together both on YouTube and Facebook at the same time. And what I want to announce is that I'm on Wednesdays at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That's my local time here in Vaughan, Ontario, Canada. For those of you that haven't met me yet, my name is Dr. Walter Salubro. I'm a corrective care chiropractor in Vaughan, Ontario, Canada. The city of Vaughan is just the suburb north of Toronto. Toronto is the biggest city in Canada, and I was born and raised in Toronto, and I, second half of my life and beyond, I grew up in Vaughan. So that's where I practice in Maple, Ontario, which is one of the hamlets in Vaughan. So what we're going to do is every Wednesdays, I'm committing to every Wednesdays at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time to do a live question and answer show right here on YouTube, and I'll simulcast it also on Facebook now that I know that I can simulcast both YouTube and Facebook. And to the best of my knowledge, I think I'm the only chiropractor right now out there, at least on YouTube, maybe even on Facebook, that will be doing a live question and answer show just like this. Also, what I want to say is that it's kind of a disclaimer that I'm not here to give you specific recommendations for your specific condition. That's up to you to figure that out with your doctors and practitioners. No doctor can actually give specific advice or diagnoses or opinions, through this medium. This is general information. And you have to bring it to your practitioners and then make sure that it's suitable for you. Okay, so I want you to understand it's very, very important. Okay, so, and if you're on right now live, do leave a message or a question in the chat box. And what we'll do is we'll get to those live questions in just a moment. Okay, now let me bring up a picture here. Let's see if I can do this. Right on. Okay, so here's a picture. There's two pictures. It's an aerial view of a segment of the spine. So this one here, this is a healthy disc, and this one here is an injured disc. Okay, now let me expand this a bit. One second here. Okay, nice and big for you to see that. So here's a nice healthy disc. You see the outer rings? These are called annular fibers or annulus fibrosis, tough fibrocartilage, outer structure. The inside lighter color here is the inner nucleus pulposus. Okay, very, very strong. And you'll see that you can't see the other bone underneath, but the disc will cushion between two bones. Okay, so the bone, the vertebra is here, the disc is below, vertebra, disc, and above. Behind the spinal column, behind the actual vertebral column here, is the spinal cord. The spinal cord stems from the brainstem all the way down to the upper part of the lumbar spine, which is the L1 and L2 area. after L1, so that's here. L1, L2, somewhere around there is where the spinal cord will end. On the inside of that, okay, so below from L2 down here, the spinal cord branches off into a bunch of nerves inside the spinal canal called the cauda equina. If you heard of cauda equina syndrome, that's where that comes from. It resembles a horse's tail. Cauda in Latin equals or means tail, and equina refers to horse. So that's what it looks like, and that's what it was called originally during discovery. And then those nerves will branch out just like this over here on the side, and then go into the gluteal area, hips, lower pelvic organs, and also into the legs, posterior part, back part of the thighs, and all the way down to the back of the calf and into the foot. So it's very common. Now, this is an upper, either a thoracic or upper lumbar model here in this picture because the spinal cord is there. But if you can imagine, if this disc bulge is bulging back, right? So let's see if I can do this, okay? So right here, so bulging back, here's an injured disc. You see the nuclear fibers, right? They're disrupted, they're injured. The red now signifies the nucleus pulposus, which is leaking out. It starts off, so it usually starts off with a wear and tear on the annular fibers. It weakens that strong fibrocartilage structure, that disc. Now, the integrity of the disc, the containment of the disc, is now disrupted. And that's how you get that bulge. So see below over here, there's another bulge here. See if I can expand that a bit more. Right there, okay? Now, if this bulge irritates this nerve, and this nerve goes into your gluteal area or thigh or leg or foot, then you get symptoms down the leg. If this nerve is irritated and goes to the bladder or bowels, then you get disruption in those organ systems. So disc bulge is not only is it a serious pain condition, however, it is also, when it progresses, it can be a very serious, can provide very serious neurologic compromise to the organ systems like the bladder and bowel, and also the sex organs. So it's a very, very serious condition, more than just pain, okay? Now, so I wanted to show you that model just to give you an idea. Disc itself, when it's injured, it's a high pain generator because it produces inflammation. And inflammation has noxious chemicals like bradykinin and lactic acid and other noxious chemicals that's released during inflammation that irritates the very delicate structures of the disc, as well as the nerves, and then other structures around the spine. So it causes a lot of pain, a lot of disruption. So it needs to be addressed, okay? I'm not gonna go too much into the correction of this. I'm just gonna give some tips about what can be done at home with some exercises. But nonetheless, the most important thing, and if you've watched any of my past Q&A sessions and tutorials, the most important thing is to discover through some kind of examination, whether it's MRI or especially a physical examination, and even x-ray analysis, to discover what the alignment of the spine is and how the alignment of the spine correlates to any disc injury or disc bulge. So the alignment of the spine should be straight from the front, and this lumbar spine should have a natural lumbar lordosis or an elliptical curve. So if the spine is disrupted like that, or like that, you can see how that will cause a disc injury over many, many years. Okay, so the alignment of the spine is integral to your overall health and mobility and functional status. And the better alignment your spine is in, the less deterioration it will result in, and the healthier you'll be, and of course, less pain, okay? So that's one of the mechanisms of disc bulges, and that's why it's very, very painful, right? So I want to show you that. So I have a couple more pictures here. I want to get into some exercises. And for those of you that are on live right now, again, thank you for coming on. This is Dr. Walter Salubro. Also, I have some questions. I will get to your questions in the chat box in just a moment. Do tell me where you're from. Okay, I always like to know where you're from, and what time is it also in your area. I'd like to know that, okay? So let's get into some exercises. Let me go and share another picture here. So I'm not going to get too heavily into too many exercises. I want to show you, I believe it's three types of exercises, three categories, and give you some examples. These are pictures, okay? Pictures of me performing the exercises. When there is an injury to the spine, and this is any part of the joints in the body as well, the position sense of those joints are disrupted. And the same goes with spinal structures, okay? So when there's disc injury or spinal injury or misaligned to the spine and wear and tear, the functional status and the neurology has been disrupted. So one of the best exercises that can be done is, let's see, one second here, is balance exercise. And I think I have that. No, not yet. Okay. Let me go into the balance exercise. Actually, no, you know what? I'll get to the balance in just a moment. I changed the order. One of the best things that can be done is mobility exercises. So here is an example of a mobility exercise. I've demonstrated this in my videos as well. This is called Mad Cat. There's been different names for it. Mad Cat, Angry Cat, Mad Cow, you name it, Cat Camel. And the idea is to create mobility in the lumbar area. Okay. Now, with all exercises, people ask me, when do I do them? How often do I do them? And so forth. Generally speaking, first of all, you should be cleared by your practitioner, whether it's a chiropractor, physiotherapist, or medical doctor, or specialist. Make sure that you can do them within your tolerance and according to your condition. And second of all, an exercise should never be performed if, while doing the exercise, it causes pain. Okay, very, very important. Okay, and so it should never be performed if it causes pain. I'm not talking about a little bit of discomfort. Some discomfort during exercise is kind of expected. It's not going to cause harm. So that's harm versus, a little bit of discomfort versus harm. So it's not going to cause harm. But if it's more than that and it's really painful, then you have to stop doing it and don't do it. Okay, so you don't do a exercise during pain, and don't do an exercise if after you've done it causes pain as well. Okay, so the starting position is on all fours, hands and knees, nice square box over here. Okay, hands and knees right there. Okay. And then the next thing you're going to do is, how do we get out of here? There we go. You're going to round the back. I call it rounding the back. Okay. Rounding the back. So even though it rounds the mid back, it's creating a posterior pelvic tilt over here. Okay. And then the next exercise, the next part of this is arching the back. Now over here in this picture, I made a correction because I'm making a low back exercise guide, PDF guide, it'll be out pretty soon. My knee should be closer to my hand. So this distance here should be closer. So the knee should be somewhere around here. Okay, so I corrected that in another picture that I have. So this is arching the back like this. Okay, and then rounding. So you're going to go back and forth to your tolerance and create a nice rhythm in there and get all those spinal joints moving. This is also good for someone that has a healthy back and help be preventing any accumulation of degeneration over time. So what this does is helps create some mobility into that lumbar spine from top right down to the bottom, including L5, so L4, L5, and L5S1, because the sacrum is sitting right over here, and creates that imbibition and fluid. That motion also helps to inhibit pain response, okay, through mechanical receptors, right? As long as it's tolerable, it's something that can be done, 10, 20, even 30 times, okay? So that's a great mobility exercise. Now, this one here is, okay, lying flat on your stomach, you're going to go into extension, okay? So it's full extension. This is Superman, okay? Hands up, legs up, thighs should be higher off the ground over here, okay? So what you're doing is you're activating the entire posterior chain of your muscles, getting some strength and activation there. You're activating the glutes. The glutes, for many, many people, when I test them out, for many people, the gluteus maximus is what I call sleepy. It's not fully activated. The entire fibers of the gluteus maximus, which is a leg extension muscle, it extends your thigh, your leg, your thigh, as you're propelling forward and walking. In most people, it's sleepy. It's not activated 100%. Sitting postures will cause that to happen. Us being sedentary, not active. So, and there's ways that I can test this in the office. So doing a hip extension exercise or a Superman to activate the glutes and the lower lumbar spine is very important to strengthen those extensors, to increase muscle tone in the extensors of the back. Super, super important for coordination, stability, and strengthening that lower back to help support the muscles and tissues around that disc injury, okay? This may not be possible early on when the discs are irritated, inflamed, and super painful. But this is something that we add afterwards. So I normally start off with a mobility type of routine, whether it's the seated pelvic tilt that I mentioned earlier, the mad cat exercise, angry cat exercise, cat camel exercise. And then I'll get into some stretching routines. I'm not talking about stretching today, but I'll do get into some stretching routines and then some strengthening, some easy core back stability strengthening, and then some more advanced. Okay, so that's Superman, hands up higher if you can, and thighs up off the table or off the ground or bed. Okay, and then what else I have here? Now this one is a great one. This one I was talking about earlier. Okay, this type of work here, this is balance training. I can tell you, so I'm a corrective care chiropractor, and I work on spinal correction and spinal rehabilitation, structural rehabilitation of the spine. And this is more of a functional exercise. This is balance training for the proprioceptors, which are the position sensors of the joints. Our spine has a tremendous amount of position sensors, especially in the neck area and also lower back, sacral area. Okay, very, very important. Okay, and as well as the ankles and the knees. So we're activating this through the entire proprioception system, okay, joint position sense system. And when there's injury, as I was saying earlier, because I got my order wrong and forgot the order of the exercises, but as I was saying earlier, that balance training is super important and it's often missed. I'll give you an example. Okay, if you ever sprain an ankle playing soccer, basketball, walking on the street, whatever it is, right? You sprain an ankle. Let's say you sprained your right ankle. And let's say that you've never had it properly rehabbed. It just went away on its own, the pain. The swelling went on its own. I can get you, I can immediately do a test and determine how good or bad your balance and proprioception is. So if you stand on that, on the good ankle, lift your leg off the ground and stand on the good ankle, you should be able to balance pretty good. That's what I'm doing right now. And if you stand on the bad ankle and lift your opposite leg, you'll see that you're going to be wobbling. That's because that ankle never got rehabbed for proprioception and balance. And the same thing goes with the spine. So what I do to give my patients is balance exercises. So you get a line on the ground. It can be imaginary or it can be a strip of masking tape, 5 to 10 feet long, whatever you can do to your tolerance. And you do what's called heel to toe walking. So here I'm putting one foot on the line and then I put the other heel and I touch the other toe. It has to come all the way around on top of that line and touch the toe. Heel has to touch the toe without any compensating back and forth with your hands. The more you compensate off the line with your hands, knees, and ankles, the more disrupted that proprioception system is and the more work it needs. The nice thing about this is that it trains pretty quickly. Within 2 to 4 weeks of doing this anywhere from 5 to 7 times a week, it trains very, very quickly. And I see people recover really quickly with their proprioception. So that's the starting point. They just kind of walk the line. Okay. And of course you can also do it backwards. Okay. But I would suggest practicing forward first. So you turn around and then do it forward the other way. And eventually you can do it forward, then you do it backwards, and then eventually you can do it with your eyes closed. So it's ways of challenging through that balance training. Okay, so this is more advanced functional work when it comes to back rehab, okay? And something that we do with our patients, right? So those are the three exercises I wanted to share with you. Kind of different, but yet unique and super, super helpful. And I'm going to get into the live question and answers right now. Before I do that, so don't go away. I'm going to go through all your questions and answers. We have people here from Facebook and YouTube today because I'm simulcasting for the first time on two platforms, which is pretty cool. What I want to tell you is that from this point forward, I'm committing starting next week, Wednesday, which is Wednesday, August 26th at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So let's see if I can put this here. So Wednesday, 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, live Q&A. Let's see, does that work? Beautiful. Wednesday is 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, live Q&A. That's something I'm going to commit to as part of my YouTube channel. So if you're a member of this channel, subscriber, I appreciate you. If you're watching on Facebook, I appreciate you as well. And do share this with your family and friends and like this and plug into your playlists. And, you know, this is for all of you that have struggled with getting results with your back problems or degeneration or disc injuries. And, you know, I've had so many people come in my office, and the most common theme of every single person that's come into my office is this, is that I've been to a therapist, I've been to my doctor, I've been to this office, I've been to this clinic, I've had this MRI done, I've had this test done, I've had nerve conduction, I've been to this pain specialist and gotten pain injections, pain medicine injections done, you name it. And then still 3 years later, they come with a pack of reports like this. They have the same condition of their back. It's not getting better, it's getting worse. It's the most common theme that I've seen so far in my office in the last several years. And that's the reason why I'm putting out my YouTube channel, that gives people tips and strategies on relieving chronic back conditions and also showing people how we help others recover through chronic conditions, spinal conditions like disc bulges and sciatica and back pain, neck pain, numbness, tingling, scoliosis, and other postural conditions. So that's what we do. And what I want to do now is every Wednesdays at 1 p.m., maybe a half an hour, maybe shorter, maybe longer, we're going to take live question and answers just like today. So what I do now is, so be sure you tune in on that, okay? And if you don't catch it live, you'll catch the replay. So let me get into some of the questions and answers from the chat box right now. And if you're still on, I appreciate your questions because I'm going to go back to the ones early on. And if you didn't catch it live, then catch the replay, hopefully, okay? So first one I have is from Anna. Let's see. So I'm reading this for the first time. So what about if you have bursitis with a bulging disc? Okay, so bursitis is inflammation of a bursa. A bursa is a fluid-filled sac, usually around the joint, like a hip joint or shoulder joint or a knee joint. And I haven't heard of bursitis in the back, so I'm thinking maybe bursitis of the hip. It obviously is going to be very painful at the same time, which needs to be addressed. Something like physiotherapy, laser therapy of the bursitis area can be very helpful. And then with the bulging disc, corrective work on the spine can be very helpful as well. Okay, so that's something that can be done. Helen, hello, Helen. Thank you, Helen, from Nigeria. Good evening. That's awesome. It's evening there. It's late afternoon here. Thanks for tuning in. We have Zinmo. I have an L405 lower back pain, and I'm very worried about how can I recover from the pain by doing stretch exercise. That's a very good question, Zinmo. So if you look at my YouTube channel and you look at the videos that shows exercises, a lot of people have commented how exercises have helped them. Just doing the short little routines that I've given people, how they have helped them. I can't attest that it's going to help every single person by just doing exercises. That's not always possible. It's like not all medications help all people, right? They help a lot of people, but they don't help all people. So it's the same idea, because there could be other things going on that need to be addressed. And people's bodies will take interventions differently. So if exercises and stretches help, that's great. If not, then it needs to be investigated further. And I'm not sure where you're from, Zin. Maybe you can tell me. But one of the great ways, not the only way, but one of the greatest ways or best ways is to have the spine assessed by a chiropractor that works on correcting the structural distortions of the spine that led to the L405 lower back pain injury. Okay, so that's very important. Okay. Surgeon, hope I said that right. I have tingling in the fingers of the right foot. So that's the toes. What is the medical reason for that? Good question. So when there is tingling in the toes, tingling is usually a result of nerve irritation. It can be from a peripheral nerve in the calf, or it can be from a spinal nerve in the lower back sacral area. So that needs to be investigated. I can't give you a definitive reason why you have it, but that needs to be investigated. Also, there can be metabolic reasons for tingling in the toes, like a diabetic neuropathy. So that's something that needs to be investigated as well. And that's usually a progressive end stage part of diabetes. Okay, so but most common is going to be some kind of musculoskeletal reason or a neurologic reason. Okay, Irma, is advice for herniated disc also? So I'm not sure what she's asking, so I'll move on. So Mukasunda. My back, it pains me every day whenever I sit. Sometimes I don't have my sleep at all. What can I do? So sitting with low back pain from sitting, I hear this very, very often on a daily basis. And it can be from the lower. So let me use my spine model here, my pediatric spine model. So my small one. So right here. And do I have a pen? Yes, I do. So there could be pain in the lower lumbar area right here. Okay, or there can be pain in the sacroiliac joint over here, or inflammation in the sacroiliac joint over here. Typically, the sacroiliac joint is a common area that gets irritated with sitting. The pelvis gets stressed during sitting, causes irritation on those ligaments of the sacroiliac joint on the side, and that can cause sitting pain. So again, chiropractics help many, many people with lower lumbar disc joint irritation and also sacroiliac joint irritation, something that you can look into, okay? Okay, Zinmo, I suffered this pain about 6 months and cause of lifting more weight without doing a warm-up. Now I sometimes suffer only lower back pain. I want to recover this pain completely. Give me some advice. Good. The best advice I can give you, Zen Mo, is to get it checked by a professional practitioner, whether it's a chiropractor, physiotherapist, or medical doctor. And you'll see that I tell people to go to all three, right? Or any of those. I can't tell you what would be the best thing for you. So you need to figure that out. I can tell you in my experience that chiropractic has helped many, many people, and corrective chiropractic care has helped many, many people. I've seen it in my office and across many other offices. But you need to see, the bottom line is you need to get an investigation of your spine, okay? A proper investigation. So if you go to the medical doctor and they don't give you a proper investigation, maybe they can give you other tests like CAT scans and MRIs. That's great. But then what are you going to do with that information? You go to a physiotherapist. They can do a thorough examination and give you some protocols of correction. But if that doesn't work, they have to try something different. For a lot of people, it, you know, that can be chiropractic. So any one of those things that works for you. Remember, medical doctor is going to give you more, lead more towards drugs and surgery. Physiotherapist, more towards exercise and physical modalities. And chiropractic, more towards structural correction of the spine. And oftentimes, these conditions are because of structural distortions of the spine. And that's why chiropractic helps a lot of people. So I just wanted to make those distinctions. Okay, Anna Iluzzi. So, can you reply here? My signal is bad. We are having bad weather. I'm not sure what the question is, Anna. Is it further up? Yes, that's right. I did get to that about the disc bulge and the bursitis. Okay, Annette, you're from San Antonio. Welcome to the show. Zen Mo, I'm from Myanmar. Awesome. 2:45 a.m. That's great. Mohammed from UAE. Great. Thanks for tuning in. Martin from UK. Awesome, Martin. I just spoke to someone from UK over the telephone today and help him find a chiropractor, a corrective care chiropractor in the London area. So sometimes we do that as well. Annette, what if you're dealing with mid-moderate spinal stenosis, spondylosis with disc bulge and annular tear? So that's a lot to deal with. And there are certain therapies, exercises, and motions, functional things that can be done for that. Again, it needs to be addressed properly structurally. Of course, a chiropractor can address that, a therapist or a medical doctor, but there are things we can do with chiropractic that can help with that. So those are things that we see on a regular basis in a chiropractic office, and we've seen many people resolve from those. Okay, Erin from Hungary, thanks for tuning in, Erin. Martin, okay, I have three disc degenerative disc disease. What is this and what does it mean? Okay, great question, Martin. So I'm not sure if you caught this earlier. So let me just get back to my picture here. Okay, so right here. Okay, here's a healthy disc. Healthy disc, nice annular fibers, nucleus pulposus, and then you're seeing an aerial view of a healthy disc. The one to the right over here, this one here is a degenerated disc. So where's your question here? There we go. So this irritation and all these bony spurs around the end plate of the vertebral body, this disruption in this disc, this is called disc degeneration or degenerative disc disease. So usually degenerative disc disease is diagnosed on an x-ray, because an x-ray, you cannot see a disc bulge. A disc bulge is a soft tissue which cannot be seen on an x-ray. All you can see is the spacing. So if the spacing of the disc is narrow or compressed compared to the other ones, that's indication of degenerative disc disease. An MRI will show a disc bulge, disc herniation, okay? So degenerative disc disease is disruption or deterioration of a disc, and especially when there's bony spurs around that vertebral end plate, which is around here, that's degenerative disc disease. Okay, hope that answers your question. Right on. Okay, Irma from Washington State. Welcome, awesome. All right. Hi, Matthew. I'm going through all here. All right. Matthew's from Newmarket, Ontario, and I live in Aurora, so we're neighbors practically, Matthew. Great. Right on. And Mohammed. So here's a couple questions for Mohammed. So I'll tackle both of these here. So hi, everyone. My name is Mohammed. Great. Now I'm in Ireland. That's awesome. I have a bulging disc between C5 and C6, and I do have several videos about C5, C6 disc bulges. I'll post them in the description below. L3, L4, and L4, L5, and L5S1. That's lots of damage going on. And just so people know, C5, C6 is the most common area of the cervical spine. Cervical spine, where are we here? So in the middle, C5, C6, the most common area for disc degeneration and disc bulges, because it's the rounding part, it's the apex of that cervical curve. and it's the part that takes the most irritation. And then L405 is the most common area for a lumbar disc deterioration. And then it's L5S1, then oftentimes L3, okay? So those are very common areas, Mohammed. Currently, I'm seeing a physiotherapist and a chiropractor. That's awesome. And a lot of my patients do concurrent chiropractic care in my office, plus physiotherapy or even acupuncture. So my question is this. Is the chance of full recovery? What is the chance of Cotty Quina syndrome? My L5S1, a bulging posteriorly and laterally, and is it worse? And it is the worst in the lower lumbar spine. Okay, great questions, very legitimate questions and legitimate concerns. I've had thousands of people come to my office, hundreds of people with disc bulge, and I personally have not seen yet a Cotty Quina syndrome patient in my office. Doesn't mean it's not possible, doesn't mean it doesn't exist. It's just extremely, extremely rare. Now, when someone has a known disc bulge or disc herniation in the lower lumbar spine, L405, L5S1, they need to be aware of the red flags, low back pain red flags or Cotty Quina red flags, these are Cotty Quina red flags. Number one, shooting pain down both legs, so like zapping shooting pain down both legs, okay? Especially if they come in with just one side of leg pain or gluteal thigh pain. Then one day they wake up and they have zapping shooting pain down both legs. That's an immediate concern. The person needs to go to the hospital, the ER, for a checkup and may require surgical decompression. If they lose function and control of the bladder and bowel, so going to urinate or having a bowel movement, within 24 hours, you have the urge and you want to go to the bathroom, but you cannot physically eliminate. That could be a sign of neurologic compromise, the nerves that control the bladder and bowel. That requires immediate hospital visit, ER, and possible immediate surgical decompression. These are symptoms of Cotty Quina. If there's what's called saddle anesthesia, or saddle paresthesia, if you can imagine the inner thigh and the gluteal butt area where you're sitting on a saddle of a horse, right, that inner area, those nerves there come from the lower sacral nerves. And in order for them to be irritated, you need a massive disc bulge or herniation inside the spinal canal, in the lower lumbar area. So it's very, very rare. So if there's a saddle anesthesia or paresthesia suddenly appears and you feel numb in that back area of your bum and inner thigh area, then that requires immediate visit to the ER and possible surgical decompression. Of course, that's going to be up to the surgeon to figure that out. So those are very, very, very rare. I've yet to see any of those, although I always warn my patients about them. So what's the chance? I'm thinking there's always a possibility, but it's usually rare. And in order to prevent the possibility, you just need to be aware of the things you're doing. So you should avoid bending and lifting, turning, twisting, pushing, pulling, especially when you have an active disc herniation or disc bulge. So those are things you need to be cautious of. Very, very important. Okay. And where is it? Where it's worse in the lower part. Yeah. And then the chance of recovery. So what's the chance for recovery? So that's one of the most common questions. I talk about this in a few of my videos, and I'll put the links of those videos in the description below as well. What's the chance of a disc bulge healing? L405 or L5S1 disc bulge? What's the chance of it recovering? And I never, like, people ask me, can I fix my disc bulge? Can it go back inside? Can it be resorbed? And that's not the goal of my therapy. And I've helped many people recover from disc bulge injuries and conditions. I just don't know if it's going to resorb or resolve or you know, retreat or retract back into proper position. But my objective is to figure out the spinal condition and alignment. Okay, let me get rid of this here. To figure out the spinal condition and alignment, seeing if it's aligned properly or not, or, you know, could be too much curve or too little curve in the lower part of the spine. And then assessing the structural integrity and alignment of the spine, and then working on correcting that structural integrity and alignment of the spine, bringing it back to a better position. And in doing so, now relieve the abnormal loads on the discs, the abnormal irritations, and now give it a chance to heal and you know, go through the entire healing process and limit the inflammation process. And now the back is going to be able to heal and get better. So that's what I've seen with a lot of patients. That's been our approach, and it's helped many, many people. So I've seen people recover fully, which means functional improvement, mobility is improved, walking is improved, sleeping is improved, more energy, less stress in their body and overall life. And of course, pain is gone, or 95% gone, 90% gone, and some, in many cases, fully gone. So I've seen that kind of recovery. But to say, will the disc actually change or improve on the inside? Don't know. And that's not the goal of my type of care. Zinmo, thank you very much. I appreciate it. Mohammed, in addition to bulging disc between C5 and 6, thanks in advance. Okay, I'm in western part of Ireland. Awesome. Thanks for that. I would love to visit Ireland one day. Okay, Helen, thank you, Dr. Francis, for my question. It's Helen again from Nigeria. Hi, Helen from Nigeria. Please keep it safe. Is it safe to drive with a bulging disc and herniated disc? Great question. Okay, so again, I've seen patients with acute pain due to disc bulging, disc herniations, and it's very challenging for them to sit in a seated position. Therefore, very, very challenging for them to drive. What happens is typically their spouse will drive them or family member will drive them. I've seen that happen many times. So in an acute situation where there's tremendous amount of pain and limited functional mobility, you're not going to be able to control the pedal and be, you know, you're just going to be so irritated with your pain. You're not going to even be a full alert for your surroundings. So I wouldn't recommend driving at that point. If there's mild disc bulge pain, mild disc herniation pain, tolerable, and you can be alert while you're driving and you can still tolerate sitting for, let's say, 30 minutes or so, or even an hour if you can, if you can tolerate that without exacerbation or flare-up, then yes, it can be safe. You can even put a little roll, like a towel roll or a small little pillow behind the lower part of the back to help, you can rest against that pillow or roll, and that will help relieve some pressure in that lower back area. So it depends on this, on the condition, okay? Second, hi, sir, I have a disc bulge, L5, S1, L3, L4, please tell me what to do. So it's a good question. And I know you know you have a disc bulge and you probably had that assessed with an MRI. The best thing I can tell you to do is to see some kind of therapist or chiropractor that will help determine the structural condition of the spine and start working on the structure of the spine to improve the condition that led to those disc bulges. Okay? Matthew Nicolini, what are your thoughts on decompression therapy? I've been to a multitude of chiropractors to treat L4, L5 bulge. Grazie. It sounds Italian, which is my heritage Italian, although I'm born in Canada. Both my parents are Italian. So welcome, Matthew. So, I've heard a lot of good things about decompression therapy. I do not do decompression therapy in my office, although I know colleagues that do it and other doctors in the area, and I've heard a lot of good things about it. Does it help every single person? I don't think so, and I've heard that also. Just like chiropractic care may not help every single person either, same as physiotherapy and drugs and injections. So there are merits to it. I understand the reason why it's done. So to give you an example, if there's a disc bulge, a posterior disc bulge, so hard because the camera is opposite. Posterior disc bulge or posterior lateral disc bulge in there. So think of this going back more, right? Decompression, you're on your back typically. Let's see, okay? So on your back and the spine is being decompressed from here to here. So it's being decompressed like that, okay? So basically what I'm doing is I'm doing this, okay? And usually it's a rhythmic decompression, okay? And the idea is that it's going to help relieve pressure on that disc. And there are reasons when that's important. So yes, it could be helpful. The best way to determine is if you're a candidate is to get checked by a doctor that does decompression, have proper MRI analysis, X-ray analysis, and then you figure out for yourself. So, and yes, you've been to a multitude of chiropractors. I totally get that. I hear that from a lot of people. I don't know how to say this, so I'm going to say it lightly, but not all chiropractors are alike. I think chiropractic is a great, I know chiropractic is a great, great profession for structural correction of the spine, but not all chiropractors focus on structural correction of the spine. I do, and I know a lot that do, but not all of them do. So you may go to 10 different chiropractors and get 10 different assessments and 10 different approaches to care. So if you're looking for structural correction of the spine, then you got to go to a structural corrective chiropractor. If you need help finding one, let me know, and I'll post it in the comments below, okay? Cool. Okay. A few more questions, then I'm going to wrap this up. Okay. If you guys are enjoying this, okay, if you're enjoying this, let me know in the comments. Okay. Say I'm enjoying this. If you find this question answer show useful, then I'll keep doing that 1 p.m. Wednesdays at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time over and over again. Okay. So I'll keep doing it serially only if I know that you find this useful. Okay. So if you don't find this useful, then this will just happen every once in a while. Okay. And maybe not at all. Okay. But I want to make sure that I'm providing value to you. I love doing what I do. Every single day I wake up and I know that I change people's lives. They come in pain, they can't move, they can't walk, and then weeks later, months later, they're back to normal function and better, and they're living their life the way they want it. So that's what gets me going as a chiropractor. The other thing that gets me going is, as I said earlier, is that way too many people have been misguided, no fault of their own or your own if it's you, been misguided through many different ways, and never really found a solution to the back problem. And what we want to do is offer them a solution from a corrective perspective. Okay, so that's why I get passionate about that. So if you enjoy this, let me know, leave it in the comments below. Also, excuse me. Also, I know that the stream is delayed. So if I don't respond to your questions or remarks, it's because it's on delay. Okay, so let's see. Okay, Sakit, I felt numbness on my right leg and it's pain a lot. Totally get it. Something needs to be checked. Check with a chiropractor, a therapist, or your medical doctor. Very, very important. Okay, Mohammed. Okay, when can I go back to my routine activities as bending forward, driving, playing soccer, running, and so on? Another thing, can I travel by plane? Okay, so this is one of those times where I cannot tell you specifically what you can do. Okay, I hope you understand that. And I hope you can appreciate that. You need to be cleared by your own doctor and practitioner because they know your condition specifically, right? I think you can understand that, right? So generally speaking, I return patients back to their activities like sports and their routines like working on the gym. When I know that I test them in the office, range of motion and other things that we do. And as long as they can go through some mobility and range of motion without discomfort and they've had no pain for several weeks, then they can start to slowly progress into their activities and sports. Okay. So that's one thing. Another thing, traveling by plane. If you can tolerate sitting, so think about your flight. If your flight is 3 hours and you can tolerate sitting in a chair or driving in a car for 3 hours, then that should be okay. If your flight is going to be 8 or 10 or 12 hours and you can only tolerate sitting in a chair for 1 or 2 hours or 3 hours, it might not be okay. And it might be making for a very uncomfortable flight, especially if you can't be mobile up and down the aisles. So that's a judgment call. You need to really assess that. Okay. Warren Isaac. So I have a break between L4 and L5. So I'm not sure what you mean by a break. Okay. So break sometimes means fracture. So I wonder if it's a fracture or a pars defect. Okay. So my surgeon is leaving the decision up to me what to operate. So it sounds like a fracture or something going on there. Maybe a disc. It's been 3 years. Is it theoretically possible to go without having surgery at all? Good question, Warren. I think it's a very good question. I can't give you a specific answer because I haven't seen your x-ray, MRI, or look at your overall clinical picture. However, again, it depends. If there's instabilities and there's severe degeneration and the severe disc bulge, it's possible that it might need surgery. But in many cases, I've seen surgery be avoided. So it's hard for me to know without a full examination, okay? So the best way to do is to get a second opinion from a non-surgeon. So you got your surgical opinion, right? So now you get an opinion from a structural chiropractor or someone else, another therapist, and see if they can do something within their experience to get you to the point where you're avoiding surgery, okay? So it all depends on your specific situation. Okay, Mohammed, thanks a lot for answering your questions, for sure. Oh, thank you. Appreciate it, Mohammed. Okay, the soccer that I like, yeah, you're very welcome. Awesome. Ireland, amazing. Love it. Okay, thank you. Matthew says, thank you, Mohammed. Really helpful and enjoys my videos. Awesome. And then we have MeHC. I'll be trying these exercises. Thank you. Awesome. Good. So I went through every single one of the questions, and some of you are still on, so I appreciate it. So what I want you to do is, if you like this, make sure you hit the like button. Share this with your family and friends, send it through WhatsApp or Facebook Messenger. And also, I know you're subscribed because you got the notification. If you are new watching this as a new person viewing my channel, do subscribe every Wednesdays at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I want to see you guys here, okay? I want to build this up. We're going to have 22 people on. I think I had a maximum of 24 so far live. I want to see up to like hundreds of people on here. Let's try to make changes in the entire people that need some change and direction with their spine and their degenerative conditions, and you know, introduce people to strategies and tips, answer some questions, give some hope. That's what this is about. And also introduce a corrective chiropractic care. I may even bring some other guest speakers and interview some specialists and other chiropractors and researchers in the field of spinal structural corrective care. I've done that before on Facebook, so I may do that again as well on this YouTube show. But this is really for you to give you hope, give you inspiration, let you know that there are other means out there besides, you know, just medicine, drugs, injections. Okay. So hang in there. I got a couple more questions. I'm going to answer these last few questions, then I'm going to sign out. Okay. Helen, I'm very, very happy and grateful to be on your live chat. I'm really blessed by this and would love to see you again. Looking forward to it. Thank you. Okay. 1 p.m. Wednesdays, Eastern Standard Time. That's what it's going to be. Cody Miller. Hey, Cody, how's it going? My radiculopathy just moved from top of my thigh to inside my knee, not seizing up, but I'm feeling like a sprain or twist. The swelling. Okay, got you. Very cool. Make sure you follow up with your doctors. Very, very important. And Mohammed Salah, awesome. Appreciate you all. This is Dr. Walter Slubro, Corrective Care Chiropractor in Vaughan, Ontario, Canada, signing out. And don't forget, 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, every Wednesday's live Q&A just like this. Love you all, and I'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye.